Hello and welcome. My name is Ben Brownlee for Boris Effect. And what we're going to be doing now is taking some of the lessons that you've learned in the other part of the Understanding Particle Illusion course, and then putting all of these things together to create one steam system. So we're going to be looking at taking our preset, customizing it to our needs, and adding in some forces so that we can then use it and composite it in our edit system. So let's have a look at it. We're now back in the Particle Illusion interface, and it's time to start hunting for some steam. So I'm going to come into my browse layout, and I'm going to search my emitters for steam to try and find one that actually fits what I'm after. And we want to get some steam rising out of a cup, so we've really got to be quite careful in choosing what our starting point is going to be. We've got boiling steam, which is pretty nice if you've got something on a stove. Rising steam. This is kind of interesting. We'll come back to that maybe. Steamy smoke. Yeah, maybe not. And steamy smoke column. This looks a little bit too fiery for me. I think I'm going to go with the rising steam. This has a nice sort of base movement that we can start to work with and tweak up a little bit. So let's change my layout back to the default and put this on the stage. So I'll just double click on my rising steam and it pops onto the stage there. And I can move into my edit layout now. So let's position the emitter where we want it. Now in the first instance, I'm going to render out this element and use it on another clip. So I'm not quite sure how big I want it. So I'm just going to make it fairly large. I'll bring it back down to the bottom here. And we're going to use zoom rather than size to move everything up. Now I'm going to add a bit more depth into this steam by increasing the number. This is also something I can do in the emitter itself. So just come up to my number and maybe double that over to, actually more than double that, maybe quadruple that to about 600. So I'm making quite a lot of particles now. And this isn't so much looking steamy anymore. This is looking more sort of smoky than steamy. Now, when we're looking at steam, it's actually a little bit different than smoke because steam is made up of water particles and it's often not even that visible unless we're looking at it in a certain light. So if I bring up the number here, I'm also going to consequently bring down the opacity. This is often something we can do to create a much fuller effect, but obviously at the expense of a bit more processing because we are spitting out more particles than we were previously. But this is still playing back in real time, so I'm not really worried about that. If you were suffering some sort of slowdowns, obviously this is something you would probably leave till a much later stage in the process. So it's the same thing, bringing the number up, but bringing the opacity down, makes it a little bit fuller. So up till now, all the changes we've made have been to the emitter itself. Just pause that for 1 second. I want to make some changes at a particle level now. So I want to start to change up the shape and the behavior of the particles themselves. And to do that, I have to go into the particle parameters. Now you can see that our steam is made up of two sets of particles. Plumes and the creatively named plumes. Not particularly useful for what we're trying to do. So I'm going to rename this by clicking on the hamburger menu, going to rename, and I'm going to go plumes top because that's where our focus is going to be on this one here. And I'm going to rename the other one to plumes bottom. And I'd heartily recommend you do put logical names in for your particles. It makes everything a lot easier when you come to edit it. So the fact that we've got two particle types is a real strength for Particle Illusion. So we can build up complex effects and control them using this single emitter. Now, the first thing I want to do is build up a slightly fuller effect closer to the bottom of the steam. So I'm going to open up my plumes and we'll have a little look at the properties of this. And the first thing I'm going to do is look at the shape image. And interestingly enough, our plumes are actually made of fire, in this case, a true flame. So I can have a little look through here and check to see whether any of these that we currently have in our library are going to give us a slightly more smoky effect or a different effect that I think is going to look better instead. As you'll have learned in earlier tutorials, the shapes where we have a little play button in the bottom left-hand corner are ones that are made up of multiple frames. So if we look at clouds one, I kind of like that one. we can actually see this is made up of 9 different shapes. So 9 different frames there. I'm going to hit apply on this. So if our shape is made up of 9 different shapes, surely we'd be able to see that animating. Well, in this case, we can't. And the reason is because we have use single frame turned on. I'm going to turn off use random frame and use single frame. And let's just see what happens to our smoke now. Ugh. Okay, that's not particularly nice. That's because on each frame, we're now getting that shape cycling along to the next one. This can be really useful for things like flames or water droplets, you know, things where stuff is sort of evolving and animating through. But with our steam here, I really don't like that look. It's not the right effect for us. So I'm going to turn on use single frame. So we're only using one of our shapes. And this now brings in our uniform shape. So I'm going to turn use random start frame on, and our particle illusion will use a random shape from the 9 that make up that particular animated shape. We're going to leave the rest of these as they are. So we don't need this to be intense because this isn't a sort of flame effect. We wouldn't expect the light to build up as more and more particles go over. In fact, the exact opposite. With steam, we're sort of blocking out more and more light rather than intensifying that. So we don't really want that turned on, but we do want to change how the transparency or alpha channel is being handled by this particle. Now, if I come to alpha, you can see our alpha gradient of what happens between a particle's birth and its death. Now, in other particle systems, this is represented by a graph. In particle illusion, it's represented by this gradient. So anything that is black is going to be completely transparent. Anything that's white is going to be completely opaque. So I'm going to take off some of the opacity that's happening on the top here. Let's just stop this for a second so we can see what's happening a little bit easier. Come back into my opacity. And you'll see that if I take this stop and move it to the left, this area now is getting less opaque. So we're seeing less of the top there. And I can even add another stop in here. If I double click on it, I can take the opacity down, maybe to about 26. And I can really focus where that opacity starts to drop off. It's going to be quite nice there. So we've got a fuller body at the bottom and not quite as much happening at the top there. Now I can come to the plume's top and do, you know, almost the opposite on that. So I'll come in here and maybe just adjust what's happening at the bottom. So bring my opacity down a little bit at the start. So we're mainly affecting the top area here. If you don't want to get too granular with the opacity, we don't have to use the alpha controls here. Let's just take this back. I can just use the opacity parameter to take down the opacity across the entire particle. So steam, this is looking all right. It's just we still aren't getting a very organic look to it. So I'm going to add a little bit of turbulence. And I can do that by using the forces up at the top. So if I click on force, I can click anywhere in the area to add a force to my scene. And because I'm currently paused halfway through, so you can see with my CTI here, my force is being generated at that frame. And I'll just bring that back to the start so we can see that working now. So now I've got a little bit of force pushing my particles over to the right-hand side. It's looking all right, but we can do more. And to learn a lot more about forces, then take a look at the Understanding Forces and Deflectors tutorial, where John Dickinson goes a lot more in depth about what's happening here. So I want to make this a little bit more organic. So I'm going to just turn this into a grid instead. And this automatically creates a group of forces. All of them are currently pointing in the same direction. It's over to the right. So I'm going to change the direction on my forces here. And I'm going to take this to 90 degrees so they all point straight upwards. So this is just helping to push all of my particles up a little bit higher. The interesting thing about my grid force is where I start to change up the strength variation and the direction variation. If I change up the direction variation, you can see straight away that those arrows are starting to push in different directions. And we can take this all the way up to 360, so they're just pointing in completely random directions. I don't want that to go too high. I think for this one, I can quite easily live with about 180. So I'll just double click and change that to 180. And my strength variation, I'm going to bring this upwards as well. So I'll probably bring my strength variation to maybe 60 in this case. See how that looks. And I'll just play that back. Okay, and that's starting to look a little bit more organic now, but it's not quite right. So let's stop that here. We'll come down to the forces and I'll maybe just take that strength down to zero so that all of the strength that we're getting is coming from our strength variation. We can just bring that up a little bit more. And that gives us a nice bit of variation happening on the base down here. Cool. And I'm going to add one more force just to now focus on that top area. And I'm going to turn this into a point force. So this is going to either attract or repel particles towards it. And what I'm going to do with this one, let's bring that around about here. Make that force. Oh, hang on, let's start the force at the beginning. I'm going to make the strength quite high. So we can see those particles are now being drawn towards it here. Actually, make that the strength really quite high, about 850. That's looking pretty good. And now I'm going to just animate this back and forth. I'm not going to do anything too clever with it. Just turn on my animation. Take it over here. About 30 frames in. Move it over to one side. Another 30 frames in. Move it back again. Sort of mainly keeping towards the top area there, but I don't mind if I go a little bit further down and just go off a little bit into here. So let's see what that looks like. And now you can start to see the influence that that's having, just moving backwards and forwards, just disturbing the top of it a little bit. Maybe there's like a gentle wind going in, or just the subtleties that happen when there's heat involved and changing up the little vortexes in the air itself. I kind of like that. I think we're in good shape here. Just remember, now that I'm done with animating, turn off the auto key. Make sure that is in static mode again. So now I'm happy with that. Let's come into render, and I'm going to render this out just to ProRes. And that lovely bring noise means that my render is completed. So let's use this in our project. And in Premiere, here's the clipboard we're going to add steam to. There's the rising steam, and I can just put that over the top. And we'll just animate this in quickly. So I'll just come to my blend mode, set that to screen, reposition that where I want it to go to, maybe take that, make that a little bit smaller, and we'll take the opacity down on that as well. And I can see we need to keyframe the animation a little bit to make sure that sits in the right place still. We've been working with the standalone version of Particle Illusion. Now, if we were working with a plugin version, that would give us a few things that we could do differently. So I could apply the Particle Illusion plugin directly onto my clip. And I can use the same project between Particle Illusion standalone and the plugin version. What the Particle Illusion plugin also allows me to do is also preview this over the video so I have full control over the size and velocity. I can also use the built-in version of Mocha to motion track my particles automatically. We can use the standalone version to either create and design our particles, render them out and composite them manually, or we could also transfer that data, or we could save our project, open it up in the plugin version of Particle Illusion, and do all of our tweaks directly onto the footage itself. We have a huge amount of flexibility regardless of how you use Particle Illusion, with the plugin version making it easier to customize it to your footage in situ. So we've been putting together concepts you've learned in the last few exercises. We've started with an idea, found the right preset, tweaked up the shapes and opacity so that it fits better with what we need it to do, and then used forces to give us a much more organic look. To see more of what Particle Illusion is capable of, join me in another tutorial where we focus on other features of Particle Illusion. including the forces and deflectors, or how to create complex fire elements for compositing. But thanks for now. My name is Ben Brownlee from Boris Effects, and I will see you again soon. Download Particle Illusion Standalone for free at boriseffects.com, including thousands of free emitter presets. Continue watching this Getting Started tutorial series to learn more about what you can do with Particle Illusion, and find out more about the plugin version of Particle Illusion with extra features, including built-in Mocha motion tracking, at boriseffects.com.